Hi folks, welcome back. So today I want to look at the paper that makes the case for RAID, or a redundant array of inexpensive disks. This paper was written by Patterson, Gibson, and Katz from UC Berkeley and published in the 1988 ACM SIGMOD conference. The reason I really enjoyed reading this paper is twofold. First of all, it's a great example of successively refining a design. You'll see how they successively improve the performance characteristics of a RAID configuration going from RAID level 1 all the way to RAID level 5. The second reason is that this is a great example of a very commonly occurring pattern, which is how cheap consumer level components have continuously been disrupting higher end server and mainframe hardware. What was happening in computer hardware at the time? This was 1988, so Moore's law was still in full effect. Chips were increasing their speed exponentially. But simply having a fast CPU does not mean that your overall system is fast. As Amdahl pointed out, you need to match the speed of your CPU with the speed of your memory so that your memory is able to feed data into your CPU at the same rate that the CPU is executing instructions. And to a large extent, the speed and capacity of RAM had kept up with that of CPUs. On the other hand, the speed and performance of hard disks had not followed the same trajectory. While we saw 40%, 50% increases in CPU and RAM speeds year over year, hard disk seek times were only speeding up by about 7% year over year. This led to a situation where disks became the performance bottleneck for the overall performance of your system. It was as if these really fast RAM chips and CPUs had to sip their data through a very tiny straw from the hard disk. And that brings us to the motivation for RAID. The question was, how can we increase the performance of the overall system, try to remove the storage bottleneck while still keeping the cost of the system low? If you compared some of the large expensive disks of the time with the more consumer grade cheaper disks, you'll see the vast difference in price per megabyte between those two categories of disks. However, the number of I/O operations per second per actuator of the cheaper consumer grade disks is only within a small factor of the more expensive ones, about 2x. And they consume less power and occupy less space than their mainframe counterparts. And this is what leads the authors to propose a solution which involves putting together an array of these inexpensive disks. Now, the biggest problem with putting together a lot of these disks into a single array is that their reliability is going to be absolutely dismal. If you assume that they have a constant failure rate that is independently distributed, the mean time to failure of an array is simply the mean time to failure of a single disk divided by the number of disks in that array. Which means if you have about 100 of these consumer-grade disks, your mean time to failure is only going to be around 2 weeks. What this means is that in order for RAID to work, you need a robust fault tolerance mechanism. This implies that we need to use extra disks that contain redundant information so that when one of the disks in the array fails, we can recover the information from one of the other disks in the array. And all the different RAID schemes are essentially different ways to spread out this redundant information across the array. The authors propose 5 different schemes, and they call this RAID level 1 to RAID level 5. The assumption is that when one of the disks fails, it will be replaced with a functioning disk within a very short time. That's referred to as the mean time to repair, or MTTR. The disks are organized into what they call groups, and each group has a number of data disks in it, and it also has a number of what they call check disks. These are the disks that store either redundant information or some sort of other coding information that you can use to retrieve data when one of the disks fails. And D is the total number of disks with data. This does not count the check disks. And when you add this sort of redundancy, we'll see that the mean time to failure of these disk arrays is actually very high, of the order of decades. So that is not a very meaningful metric, because that's longer than the lifetime of your entire computer system. So instead, the metrics that we are interested in are the overhead cost. This simply counts how many extra check disks you need as a percentage of the number of data disks. Another metric we want to track is the usable percentage of storage capacity. This is another way to express the reliability overhead. And what this counts is, of the entire storage capacity, what fraction is actually used for data storage. And of course, we want to track the performance of these disks. The authors here divide I/O workloads into 2 very broad categories. One is what they call supercomputer workloads, where the I/O pattern is to read and write large amounts of data sequentially. And the other broad category of workloads is transaction processing, which consists of a lot of small reads and writes that are randomly distributed. Let's start by looking at RAID level 1, which is the simplest possible thing you could do, which is mirror your data across all the disks in the array. Every write to a data disk is also a write to a check disk. This means we're only using half our capacity for actual data storage, and the other half is for check disks. Of course, this is horribly inefficient. It will pretty much double the cost of a large database system, because you're doubling the cost of your storage. This brings us to level 2 RAID, which uses a Hamming code for error correction. Now, a Hamming code is computed over a length of data or a group of data. And the problem is that if you read data that is less than a group, you still need to read the entire group in order to verify and check the Hamming code. Same thing with writes. If you're writing to only a part of data within a group, you will need to read the entire group, write the new data, and write the new Hamming code for that group. This makes the performance of this scheme for small data transfers very bad. Now we're at a place where level 2 RAID is okay for supercomputer workloads, but completely unworkable for transaction processing workloads. This has brought down the overhead costs, but we still need to work on improving the performance. And this brings us to level 3 RAID, which concentrates more on lowering the cost than improving the performance for small data transfers. Level 3 RAID involves having one check disk per group. The main observation here was that the Hamming code that was in the check disks in level 2 RAID was being used to determine which disk failed. But modern disk controllers can already give you diagnostic information which tells you which of the disks is failing, which means you can reconstruct the information on the failed disk by comparing it to the information on all the good disks. So you only actually need one check disk per group. This scheme does bring down the overhead cost by a lot compared to RAID level 2, but the read and write performance is still the same. This brings us to RAID level 4, which lets you do independent reads and writes. The goal is to be able to do more than one I/O per group at a time. And the way they do that is by interleaving the data in a different way. The data is interleaved at the level of a sector rather than at the level of bits. For example, in RAID level 3, if you wanted to read a transfer unit A, which was spread across four sectors, that data was spread across multiple disks, whereas in RAID level 4, it is all on one disk. The overhead cost for RAID level 4 is still pretty low. It allows us to parallelize reads, so it has removed most of the performance bottlenecks for reads. But when we are doing writes, we still need to write to the check disk in every group. This means that the check disk now ends up becoming our bottleneck. This is what brings us to the final RAID level, RAID level 5, which does away with this last bottleneck as well. The way we do that is by distributing the data and check information across all the disks. So in the previous scheme, you had a dedicated check disk which contained the check information, but in RAID level 5, you smear that check information across all the disks in your array. And this brings you to pretty much the ideal performance characteristics. It's the best of both worlds, where you can do a lot of random reads and writes, as well as a lot of sequential large reads with good performance. And when you look at the overall performance in terms of storage of a RAID level 5 with a mainframe large single disk, the RAID is about 10x better in terms of performance, reliability, as well as power consumption. So that was a great example of how you can cobble together these cheaper, smaller components that are consumer grade rather than enterprise grade and end up with something that is overall cheaper yet performs much better and is more reliable than the expensive enterprise grade storage system. So that was a look at how you can construct storage systems out of a redundant array of inexpensive disks. I hope you enjoyed that, and I will see you next time. Thank you very much.